Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Daniela Jongitud. I'm the founder and CEO of Shahinal Home Care Services. A lot of familiar faces. I'm here to introduce our next speaker, but before that, I want to thank the Alzheimer's Association for such beautiful events that are managed locally that gives us the opportunity to learn every year from the updates on dementia, and also because the day that we stop learning, we somehow will stop living as well. Let's then continue with our next speaker. It's going to be Dr. Alexandra Croswell. Dr. Alexandra Croswell is an assistant professor of the University of California, San Francisco School of Medicine. Her research explores how chronic stress leads to declines in physical well-being and what psychological tools and mind-body techniques can be used to combat the negative effects of stress. She has published in many of the top journals in her field of health psychology and was recently awarded a $5,000 from the National Institute of Aging to study the chronic stress of Alzheimer's and dementia caregivers, exploring what makes some people resilient and some people vulnerable to the intense demands of caregiving. She received her BA from Duke University and her PhD from UCLA in 2014. She does all of this in high heels and will be a mom of an 8-week blessing. Please help me welcome Dr. Alexandra Croswell.
Hi, everybody. Thank you, Don, for that wonderful talk and exercise. That was really a great way to start the afternoon. Today, I'm going to be talking to you about some of the cutting-edge science and research around stress. Stress, I know, is relevant for many of us in our professional and our personal lives, and I'm hoping today that you're going to walk away with a new perspective of the role that stress plays for you and for the patients and the families that you work with. I'm going to begin by telling you that there is very strong epidemiological evidence linking stress to worse physical health. And when I talk about stress, there's a variety of different experiences I mean. Some of the most compelling evidence comes from the following types of stress: work stress and burnout, experiencing difficult childhood environments, financial strain, interpersonal stress, so that means stress in relationships with our family members, living in an unsafe neighborhood, and interestingly, caregiving. And when I talk about caregiving today, most of the work that I've conducted has to do with caregivers who are family members caring for a family member with a severe disability or life-threatening illness. But there's another body of work having to do with professional caregivers, and a lot of the broader lessons and themes I'll talk about today really do apply to professional caregivers as well. And what this strong epidemiological evidence shows is that experiencing extreme forms of these different types of stressors is associated with worse physical health, including high blood pressure, metabolic syndrome, type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular disease, cognitive functioning decline, physical functioning decline, and cancer progression. And some of the recent data that I've looked at is trying to understand, what is it about stress that is so toxic for us? One of the arguments made in the stress field is that it's really all about health behaviors. So what happens is that we feel very stressed by something, so then we end up smoking or drinking more alcohol, or we gain weight and we don't exercise, and that those are the pathways through which stress influences disease. So I wanted to explore whether that's true or whether there's something toxic about the psychological effects of stress that even extends beyond these damages, the way that it damages our healthy health behaviors. And so in order to do this, I recently conducted a study examining data from a national cohort study called the Midlife in the United States study. Some of you may be familiar with this. It's a study of nearly 7,000 US adults that were randomly sampled and recruited in the US in 2004 through 2016. And they were followed and asked questions for 12 years. And over those 12 years, there was nearly 900 deaths. And in addition to following their health and their wellness, they were also asked to report on a variety of different experiences of stress that they've had, including experiences of discrimination, difficulty with friends, family members, and spouses, how generally stressed they felt within the past month, the number of stressful life events that they've experienced, such as major car accidents, natural disasters, or death of loved ones, and then social inequality. So how much, compared to those around them, do they feel that their life has been unequal? And what I was interested in understanding is, could it be that it's really about the accumulation of stressful experiences across your lifetime that somehow influences your health and well-being? And I wanted to go to the direct outcome of interest, which is death. Could it be that stress actually increases your risk of dying early? So does an accumulation of stress across your lifespan increase their risk of dying? But the next part of this research question is the most important, which is, does it do this above and beyond known mortality predictors? So if I'm not taking into account the fact that many people who are stressed end up smoking, and I tell you that stress leads to dying earlier, the most likely answer is that it's because of smoking. But what's really amazing about the power of research and statistics is we can actually control for smoking status. So what that means is I can actually look at the impact of stress on early death, taking out the effects of smoking and all other known mortality predictors. So my research question was, does an accumulation of stress in someone's life increase their risk of dying above and beyond known mortality predictors, including different demographic factors like sex, age, and race, health behaviors like smoking, alcohol use, physical activity, and your BMI, and even your number of chronic health conditions in the past 12 months? Because of course, if you were sick, you're gonna die. So let's statistically control for that when we're trying to understand the relationship between stress and early death. And finally, I also, and this is a real challenge to all my psychologist colleagues, want to control for current depression and anxiety. We know that depression and anxiety lead to earlier death. So let's even take that out of the equation and see whether we still find that experiencing a greater number of stressors leads to early mortality. And this is hot off the presses, a publication that's about to come out. And what I'm going to show you is that controlling for all these different experiences of unknown mortality factors, we still see that experiencing a greater amount of cumulative stress in your lifetime increases your risk by 20% of dying over the next 12 years. So compared to people with low levels of stress, people with high levels of stress have a 20% increased risk of dying over the next 12 years, taking into account everything else that we could imagine that would influence your risk of dying. So I hope that what you're saying is how. How is that even possible? That controlling for everything you think might explain this, stress leads to increased death. And interestingly, over the past 20 to 30 years, there has been a significant amount of research trying to understand this. And unfortunately, it hasn't really gotten out into the popular culture yet. And people still think it's a big mystery. It's actually not this huge mystery. There is very strong evidence showing that experiencing stress has direct impacts on the way our bodies are functioning. Stress leads to biological dysregulation that leads ultimately to disease and death. So those biological dysregulations include increases in chronic inflammation, high blood pressure, changes in metabolic processes, telomere shortening, endothelial function, DNA repair issues, changes in gene expression and hormonal alterations. And all of these things, the way that stress alters our bodies, causes a dysregulation that ultimately leads to disease. And what's interesting and relevant for what we've been talking about today here at the conference is that these same biological dysregulations are actually seen in full-time caregivers. Whether you're a professional caregiver or you're a family member who's caregiving, for somebody with a serious illness, we also see biological dysregulations. And we also see that caregivers themselves have an increased risk of diseases, including an increased risk of dementia. Okay, it gets good, don't worry. I'll tell you the answers for how to avoid this. We know that caregivers, and family caregivers in particular, are stressed, that they have a decreased quality of life. Now, importantly, this is not true for all caregivers. So there is a significant number and portion of caregivers who really thrive in their roles of caregiving. And that has been one of my big research questions, is who are the people who are resilient to chronic stress? And my 5-year award that was mentioned earlier from the National Institutes on Aging is actually focused particularly on trying to understand the psychological and behavioral factors that make people resilient to the chronic stress of caregiving. What are the practices in their daily life and the psychological profiles of them? Because if we could understand who these resilient caregivers are, we could help create interventions that will help other caregivers remain resilient. One interesting finding is that the difficulties that family caregivers experience are more likely to be reported in those that are classify themselves as full-time caregivers. So full-time caregivers are the ones who have had to leave their jobs or have had to completely alter their lives in order to care for their family member. And that is a distinct group separate from part-time caregivers, who are the ones that are still doing a lot to take care of their parent or their spouse who has a disease, but are quantifying it as less than full-time, so less than 40 hours a week. And so one of my the places that I began my research project was to understand what are the differences between full-time and part-time caregivers. Because if I could understand that difference, then maybe that would give me some insight into what is so toxic about being this full-time caregiver and why it's leading to an increased risk of disease. So I have data, again, this is hot off the press, not published yet. I just completed some of these analyses a few weeks ago. And what I wanted to do was compare part-time versus full-time caregivers in a variety of different lifestyle factors. So I have 1,800 part-time caregivers that I can compare to 1,700 full-time caregivers who have completed a whole series of psychological batteries on how they're doing and how they're thinking about their caregiving experience. This is from a study called the Brain Health Registry. And this Brain Health Registry was started at UCSF. It currently has 80,000 people in it. Anybody can sign up. I encourage you all to sign up and join this registry. What you do is you complete questionnaires about your life, your lifestyle, your health behaviors, your psychological states, as well as different cognitive tasks every 6 months. And the idea is that we want to have a study where we're tracking the natural cognitive progression of people over time, starting with the healthiest people. So you can enroll as young as 18 years old at any life stage. So please join if you have a few moments. And what I found by comparing part-time versus full-time caregivers is that there's some significant differences between the two groups. One of the findings I wanted to point out is that you see in the blue bar that the full-time caregivers report a greater number of physical symptoms related to caregiving. So that they say that their sleep is disrupted more, that they have more physical pain and more fatigue. And maybe that's not surprising at all, because we would assume that being a full-time caregiver is just more physically demanding than being a part-time caregiver, because you're in charge more of the time. But what may be surprising is that we actually don't see a difference between being a part-time caregiver and being a full-time caregiver on something called benefit finding. Benefit finding comes originally from the cancer literature, where there was this phenomena where cancer patients were reporting that despite the difficulty of going through the cancer diagnosis and the treatment and all that entailed, that they reported a lot of benefit from their experience. That through their suffering, they grew or their lives were enriched in some way. So their relationships were improved or their values were clarified. And that they actually came out of the cancer experience a better, happier person. And that wasn't just for a small portion. That's over 2/3 of people who go through cancer treatment report experiencing these benefits. And what we find is that part-time and full-time caregivers actually report the same thing. So both groups report finding a lot of benefit from their experience of caregiving. So they reported equal amounts of positive benefits to one's life. Another really interesting insight that I had from this initial research study is that caregivers who are full-time caregivers report high levels of a construct called role captivity. And what role captivity is that it's you feel trapped in your role of a caregiver. You feel like you can't actually explore the things in life that you want to explore, and that you can't do the things that you really want to do, and that you don't want to be doing what you are doing. So you feel trapped. And when I look and break down the data of full-time caregivers to Alzheimer's and dementia caregivers versus other types of caregivers, we see that dementia caregivers feel more trapped than other types of caregivers. And in fact, that 50% of Alzheimer's disease caregivers feel trapped in their caregiving role. And this really gave me an insight, because feeling trapped may be what's really toxic for caregivers. Because there's a lot of science and there's a biological basis for the potential toxicity of feeling trapped. And that's because our acute stress response developed a long time ago in the history of evolution of people, when we used to live in a time where we actually had to be afraid of physical predators. So you see here that that zebra is running away from that lion. Our stress response systems were developed to handle a similar problem, which was that we could at any time be attacked by a large animal. And so our physiology is based on this issue and needing in a split second moment to be able to identify a predator and activate the physiological systems necessary to get away and escape from that predator. And that feeling trapped was probably the worst thing that could possibly happen to us way back when, because there was nowhere to escape from this predator. And so feeling trapped still to this day maintains in our brain a part of the reptilian brain, the oldest part of our brain. And when it is triggered, it leaves us in a state of fight or flight, which probably many of you have heard, which is when our sympathetic nervous system or acute stress response is turned on. Our acute stress response is driven by the sympathetic nervous system. The sympathetic nervous system is a bunch of nerves that innervate a variety of different organs. And the purpose of the sympathetic nervous system is to escape from that lion. So activate your response so you know what it feels like when your hands get really sweaty and your heart rate increases and your blood pressure increases. Well, the whole idea of the stress response is to get blood flowing out to your limbs, into your feet, to your muscles, so that you can run away as quickly as possible from that lion. Now, of course, in this day and age, there are no lions, right? But there's traffic and there's work deadlines and there's frustrations in your relationships. And those modern day stressors activate our sympathetic nervous system in the same way that our systems have been trained to respond to a true and real life threat. And so one of the fundamental theories of stress and health is that it's the activation of this system that goes on for too long and is too strong of a response to be useful. Because when we're sitting in traffic and when we're feeling trapped from some experience that we're experiencing, like being a caregiver, that blood that's rushing to our muscles and to our limbs isn't useful. There's nothing to do with that increased energy that's expanded to those places. And so instead, our bodies turn that into problems. And so it uses that energy in bad ways to feed different diseases. However, the key part of the story that many of us have missed is that there are actually two sides of the autonomic nervous system. I only showed you one side, the sympathetic side. There's actually something called the parasympathetic nervous system. This is the brake for the stress response system. So we don't just have this activation side, we also have a side of us that knows when to put on the brakes. And part of my argument to you today is that we need to learn how to put on these brakes, and that there are scientific tools and ways, some of which you're actually going to get to experience in the presentations that follow me, to stimulate and activate the parasympathetic nervous system so that you can start to shut down and slow down that sympathetic reaction when you don't need to be having that extreme acute stress response. The key part of the parasympathetic nervous system is that it's activated in conditions of safety. This is a brand new theory in stress research that I'm really excited to talk about and share because I find it so compelling. And if you think back to that zebra being chased by the lion, When will that zebra be able to shut off that response? Well, when he feels safe, when he's back with his group, when he's hidden from that predator, when he knows that predator's away. So in order for his parasympathetic nervous system to click on, he has to feel safe. It's the same with us. We need to feel safe in order to activate the parasympathetic nervous system. So I hope that right now you're starting to think, when do I feel safe? What parts of my day and what parts of my life can I actually put myself in that place of safety so that I can activate the parasympathetic nervous system? And I would argue that in today's modern world, there are not enough physical places, there's not enough time in our day, and in our homes, we often don't feel safe. So we need to start creating places and spaces, starting with ourselves, where we can activate this parasympathetic nervous system by activating conditions of safety. So how can we actually signal safety to our brains and our bodies? Some of the most compelling, scientifically proven in every medical textbook is that paced, slow breathing is a direct route to stimulating the parasympathetic nervous system. Okay, so this is one of the biggest reasons that meditation is so hot right now, is because what it does is it slows down our breath. There's many other things that do that as well, like meditation and Qigong, and we'll hear about some of them later. But paced slow breathing directly stimulates your parasympathetic nervous system. And what's really cool about stimulating your parasympathetic nervous system is that it also feeds back to your brain and shuts down your ruminative thoughts. So ruminative thoughts are those thoughts that you keep thinking again and again after something stressful happens. So if somebody cuts you off in traffic and that guy is just pissing you off the rest of your day, that's ruminative thinking. And that's one of the ways that we keep that stress response aroused in our systems. So it's really important to learn tools and techniques to actually shut down that constant negative talk that's really not helping anything. So that rumination can be shut down by activating the parasympathetic nervous system from a bottom-up process. Again, meditation, yoga, tai chi, there's no magic bullet. There's no, you have to do this type of meditation for this many minutes per day. I even conducted a study where patients or participants, healthy young participants, were doing meditation for just 10 minutes a day using the app Headspace, and we showed decreases in long-term blood pressure and improvements in mood as well. So even short spurts where you're taking time to slow down your breath and to activate that parasympathetic nervous system will help in your healing process. If you have been told way too many times that you need to do yoga and you need to do meditation, and that's just not for you, let's consider some other ideas of what else might make you feel safe. And this is relevant for your patients as well. So especially for caregivers, I tried to conduct a study where full-time dementia caregivers did meditation, a very intensive form of meditation, for 30 minutes a day. They were not able to do that. It was too much, it was too intense for them to take out that time from being full-time caregiving and to do something that was so difficult, because meditation is hard and takes work and takes discipline, and it was just too difficult for them. So what else might work in our daily lives? Well, there's sensory stimulation, so aromatherapy, candles, smelling essential oils, that will get you connected to the present moment and slow down your breathing in that moment. There's also significant evidence suggesting that being in nature, seeing art, having a meaningful connection with a loved one, savoring something, which means when you're enjoying something, being able to really sit in that pleasure and feel that pleasure. And experiencing awe. There's some great research suggesting that even looking at something beautiful, like looking at the sunset, where you feel that joyful, pleasurable experience of awe, can really help stimulate the parasympathetic nervous system. And then finally, having an intentional morning or evening ritual. There's some interesting analyses my colleague Alyssa Eppel and I have recently done that's looking at how your morning is set up. So what kind of mood or state do you begin the day, and how that influences the way the rest of your day goes in terms of how stressed you feel and how or how positive do you experience the day to be. So what can you do in your lives or guide your patients to do to create intentional morning and evening rituals that, again, give you a sense of safety and stimulate the parasympathetic nervous system? Importantly, it's also important that we consider how can we signal to others that they're safe. So there's been research on communities and spaces of trusted others, such as support groups, a lot of very compelling research on choir singing, interestingly, sangha or meditation groups, church services or yoga classes, where you feel that you're surrounded by like-minded others and that you're in a space of safety and doing something ritualistic together, that you know what to do and what's expected of you so you can really relax and be present in the moment. The key here is that we're creating environments that are free of threats and judgments. And this has major implications for how we set up our homes, our workplaces, and our medical facilities, and how we're guiding caregivers. How can we make sure that the patient and the caregiver feels that their home and their space is a place that's free of threat and judgment so that we do feel safe? Some very interesting, compelling new research is also suggesting that we pick up on the physiological activation of other people. So it's a new phenomenon called physiological synchrony, which is this finding that the autonomic nervous system actually tunes itself to the people around us, and that it's more likely to tune to somebody who we perceive to be high status or in a leadership position. So that's really important in a medical setting, because when people come in with a white coat or with a badge indicating that they are, that they work here and that they have this advanced degree, we are implicitly communicating to our patients that we are in the higher status position. So when we come in stressed and frantic and bringing that stress response activation, we unknowingly can give that to our patients. So being really intentional and thoughtful about the energy that you're entering into relationships with is really important because of this new research showing that we pick up on each other's physiological activation. A lot of my work really focuses on chronic stress. So oftentimes we're told, well, you need to decrease your stress. You need to go to yoga so you're not so stressed. Well, chronic stress is a type of stress that we actually can't get rid of. So if you're caregiving for somebody, if you're a caregiver that's a professional or a family caregiver, you're not gonna get rid of the situation that is causing you the stress. So we gotta get rid of that idea that we're gonna get rid of stress. And instead of fighting it, there's a couple things we can do. We can set up environments and daily lives that activate that parasympathetic nervous system. We can create moments of rest in our day to heal from the damage and also to build up resilience to the demands of the chronic stressor. Okay, so instead of just going all day and then crashing, how can we create smaller breaks throughout the day, whether it's through slow breathing, a walk in nature, connecting with a friend, where you give your system a chance to rest, to come back down from that sympathetic activation? And finally, I've conducted some recent analyses where we looked at this idea of accepting your current reality. Many patients or many people who are chronically stressed report that they don't want that chronic stress. So it's kind of like that when I was talking about feeling trapped, that you don't want to be where you are. However, accepting versus rejecting the reality of the moment is really an important differentiation. In many wisdom traditions, and in particular from the Buddhist train of thought, acceptance of the moment, of acceptance of what is one of the foundational aspects of having a high quality of life. And that suffering actually comes from not accepting what is and from rejecting your current moment experience. And so we recently tried to examine this in a group of high-stressed moms. So we are following a group of 100 moms in the Bay Area who are caregivers because they're caring for a child with an autism spectrum disorder. And we're comparing them to a group of 100 age-matched, socioeconomically status-matched moms who are caring for the same age children who are normally developing. So we have a chronic stress group and a healthy low-stress group. And we asked them to complete a daily diary of their emotional states and their mind states throughout the day for 21 days. And what we found, maybe unsurprisingly, is that in the blue, you see these are the low-stress moms compared to the orange that are the high-stress moms. So how accepting are you of your current moment experience? And the low-stress moms report being more accepting, whereas the chronically stressed moms are less accepting. They're also more rejecting of the moment. So that means that they were saying, I don't want to be here right now. I don't want to be doing whatever I'm doing. They also spent a lot more time mind wandering, so thinking about other things. Potentially it was that negative ruminative thought that I talked about. And this is a really important distinction of accepting versus rejecting the moment, because accepting the reality of the moment is associated with better mood, increased feelings of connection to their marital partner, was associated with better sleep, even better glucose regulation and higher telomerase. I hope that some of you have heard about this book that my mentor and colleague Alyssa Epple published with Elizabeth Blackburn. And if you haven't, I encourage you to check it out. It's called The Telomere Effect. And it talks about some of the initial findings linking stress to alterations in cellular aging, and her groundbreaking research showing that our cells can actually, their lives can actually be enhanced through meditation and physical activity and other practices. So her book really outlines what are the lifestyle changes we need to make in order to be healing our cells from the damage that stress can have on us. A final point that I want to make on stress is that oftentimes we hear stress is bad, stress is terrible for our health. I even started off my talk talking about stress leads to all these things, including early death. But the key point is that stress is actually a U-shaped curve, meaning low levels of stress, zero stress, is really bad for your health. So you can think of it like physical activity. If you do no physical activity, zero, you're sitting on the couch, it's bad for your health. If you do so much physical activity, you're an ultramarathon runner who runs ultramarathons every single day for his entire life, also really bad for you. So that it's on these extreme ends that exercise is bad for you. It's the same with stress. It's on these extreme ends. So most of the research I've been citing is talking about people who have moved beyond this breaking point, where it is such a high level of stress that it is toxic. But most of us are in this blue zone, which is truly an optimal level of stress. Because if we replace the word stress with challenge, we immediately get it. Yeah, you want a little challenge in your life. From challenge comes growth. So for us, the goal is how can we stay in the blue zone? What are the tools and techniques we can implement in our own lives so that we're in the blue zone and that we, when we feel that we're kind of going to that breaking point, we know how to pull ourselves back? You know, and what are the signals and signs that you as an individual are at your breaking point? You know, you could probably sit here and list them. So we need to listen to our bodies and our minds when we feel we're there, and then have tools and techniques to bring us back to the blue zone. Because from the blue zone is where the benefit finding comes in. It's where personal, spiritual, professional growth can come in. So that's where we want to spend most of our time. So to conclude, I'm going to give you a few takeaway messages. The goal is not to get rid of stress. The goal is to create environments and daily routines that signal subconsciously to our bodies that we are safe. Because this allows our bodies to have moments of rest where it can turn on its natural healing capacities. And finally, to be aware of your breaking point and have tools to get you back into that optimal blue zone. If you need more tools to get you to that blue zone, I highly recommend the UC Berkeley Center for Greater Good. They have evidence-based techniques and tools, practices, that are between 5 and 15 minutes that you can do at home. And this is a great way to start figuring out what helps you rest during the day, even in brief moments, and what helps you get back once you're at that breaking point into the blue zone. If you were inspired by this work and excited by this area like I am, please consider being a research participant in one of our studies. We're currently recruiting for 2 different studies up at the UCSF Laurel Heights campus. In your packets, there is this information and this contact information, but we would love for you to come and participate in either of these studies that we're currently recruiting for right now. So before I open up to just a few minutes of question and answer, I'd like to thank both my research sponsors and my mentors and collaborators. Thank you. Yes, I think there should be a, Pauline in the back has a microphone coming around. We have about 5 minutes for questions.
Here. So I actually did my PhD dissertation on stress and muscle tension in 1978. And did existential therapy. I'm a caregiver for my husband. I've recently have been having many more bouts with sinus infections. So I started trying to look at the research, and it's medical, so I can't read it, but how does stress begin to cause inflammation? And it looks like most of the research is on stress as hot and cold experience.
Yeah, and so the what's your question? About the chronic inflammation or the sinus infection?
Well, if I could begin to understand how what goes in between stress and inflammation.
Oh, what goes in between? Like, how does that happen?
Yeah.
It's actually through the sympathetic nervous system. So what happens is the immune system, when it's activated and told that the stress response needs to turn on because there's a threat, it actually sends out all its little chemical messengers into the bloodstream. So these are cytokines, pro-inflammatory cytokines, because it's preparing for a wound. It thinks there's a scratch or there's an animal that's about to attack it. So the immune system needs to be ready to be able to heal the wound that's about to come. So obviously, when you're sitting in traffic, no wound is about to come. And so what happens is that those pro-inflammatory cytokines start this cascade out into the system and end up causing a lot more damage, and that's what leads to cardiovascular disease and cancer progression versus, the follow-up comment was, if you knew about your body temperature, would you be able to regulate it? I don't know any research looking at awareness of your own body temperature, but there is, we're actually conducting a study right now looking at the using cold immersion as a way to increase your stress resilience, potentially through decreases in inflammation. So thank you, everybody. Thank you for your attention.